I'm delighted to welcome my first guest, Haroon Mirza, who I'm sure many of you know, who has had a stratospheric rise in the art world, most recently with solo exhibitions, Listen Gallery, MIMA Middlesbrough, the New Museum in New York, and many, many others. The list is so long, I don't think, Haroon, the 20 minutes will will give us the time. But I did want to start with talking to you a bit about these posters, which I think some of you might have seen. There's this wonderful poster here of Haroon, which Haroon didn't even know was going to be part of this event. And you can pick them up from around the place. But I guess this triggered my first question, which is, Haroon, do you think that we overvalue the persona of the artist at the expense of the art they make?
Yes. I mean, that poster is a really good example because I really hated having my photograph taken and being on camera. And I've come to terms with it actually now, and I don't mind it so much. I'm less nervous, I guess. But I was that photograph was taken by someone that worked at Listen Gallery after I'd been working with them for about a year, I guess. And when I started working with the gallery, when they started representing me, they wanted a photograph of me, like a press shot that they could give to people. And I kind of said no the fundamental reason was because I didn't want people to be interested in me. It was my work, you know. I had something to say, and that was the representation of me. Rather, I'm not that interesting. Well, maybe my work isn't, but I hope that my work is more interesting than me and my personality and my persona and or my image. And the photograph is just the image of me. It's not. It's completely removed and completely abstracted from my work. And I think, and then in the end, Simon, who took that photo of me, and then they kind of used that, and I guess that's probably how it ended up here. I mean, I think, what was your question? Is the
persona of the artist
is not as important as, or it shouldn't be, but unfortunately, I think it has a lot to do with it.
Just picking up on that, do you think that the image of you as an artist, and maybe even your name, do you think that somehow acts as a filter for the way people look or think about your work? Is that why you want to stand way back?
Yeah, perhaps, but I mean, I don't think that's the reason why I wanted to separate myself or the image of me from my work. I think the reason was more, the answer to your question is yes, because, you know, if someone sees something in a space, and I don't know, perhaps it has been before, but my most recent work has got nothing to do with my ethnicity or my the fact that I'm a male, the fact that I'm British, and it's not, you know, it probably has, you know, fundamentally, but at face value, I don't think it has. And but that would become part of it if, you know, myself and my persona is presented with it, and I'm not sure if that's a good or bad thing, you know. It's certainly not what I'm thinking about when I'm making the work, although I can't deny that my 99% of the work is me, you know.
Yeah, of course. Another thing perhaps that acts as a filter or a way for people to frame your work or any other artist's work is the kind of gongs and prizes which have proliferated in the art world. And you won the Silver Lion at Venice in 2011. And I wondered, in that context, really, what sort of validation is important for you as an artist? It's important for the market, and to certain respects, it's important for public institutions.
Sure.
What's important for you?
I mean, if I really think about it, I'm not entirely sure I mean, of course, it's extremely important in terms of what you just said, market and museums and validation. You know, I can call myself an artist because I won this prize. It's an art prize, so therefore I can say, okay, what I do is being accepted, you know, and honoured somehow. But then, if I think about the sort of more political reasons why I might have won the prize, or the more economic reasons, or, you know, then it becomes even more complex and problematic. But if, you know, and that could lead to somewhere very dark and cynical if I continue that sort of, you know, lineage of thought. So, you know, without falling short or giving into sort of notions of paranoia or, you know, or whatever, I think there's a lot of reasons why an artist wins a prize, and I don't think they're all to do with, you know, the strength of the work. And I think that's a reality that we have to face, I guess.
Talking of paranoia, I mean, yeah. And, you know, response to work, do you ever kind of listen in to what people are saying about your work in the space? Do you ever, are you interested in what audiences are saying and discussing about your work in front of the work?
Yeah, but I'm probably too scared or nervous to try and listen. You probably can't hear it anyway because it's too loud. I mean, yeah, I guess I am. I think it's important to me how the work is experienced, because the work is kind of about experience. You know, in many ways, I think of myself as someone, I kind of produce music that can only be heard within the presence of the thing that's creating it. So in that sense, it's, you know, I kind of want to know how it works and operates. But yeah, I don't know. It's not something that I really engage in. It's not something that I do. Actually, somebody sent me a video in a gallery. There was like a security
CCTV.
Camera, CCTV, and there was someone dancing in my installation by themselves. That was quite good. Kind of like that. That was better than them saying something.
Because it was a physical response?
Yeah, because it was a physical response, yeah.
I mean, your work's often inspired by and colludes with other works, or brings objects into new configurations, which are very surprising and unexpected. Can you say something about what draws you to particular kind of objects or materials, and how you come to, why you create these marriages?
The thing is, I guess I'm probably interested in a lot of things and a lot of different things. And I think that's a symptom of the contemporary world and the internet and the way history is presented. You know, people can be interested in so many different things, and there's nothing wrong with trying to, you know, taking things that you're interested in, putting them, juxtaposing them next to another thing that you're interested in, trying to find out what happens. Where's the crossover? Where's the tension? Or where's the, I don't know, what's the synthesis between those two things? So I guess that's what I'm constantly doing, and I try to do it at a very immediate level as well. Although sometimes it can't be immediate. Sometimes you just get so involved in that, in the subject or the material, that it's kind of too worked. So I think it's just a sort of trying to kind of collate things that interest me.
Do you hoard things? Is your studio full of stuff?
Yeah, it is. But every now and again, I'll just put everything together and make one big work out of them.
Where does this stuff come from?
It just accumulates over years, mostly eBay, junk shops, or, you know, other places, you know, gifts. People give things to me. People endlessly give me televisions and speakers.
Really?
Yeah, which is great on one hand, but at the same time, it's like there's a, you know, there's a whole stack of speakers that I need to find space for. But yeah, all over the place, you know, things I might specifically try and obtain or acquire, you know, I often include artworks. So there's either, you know, relationships with artists that I have, you know, that I forge, either because I already know them or either I'm just interested in their work. So I approach them and start a conversation, or sometimes they approach me and start a conversation. So it's I'm a kind of a hoarder, but I don't like to, everything usually finds a home within an artwork or an installation.
Can you talk me through a little bit about this process? Because I have an image of this kind of accumulation of things, of material, of sound, of different elements. And then I'm imagining a process whereby you're configuring this, and out of this seemingly unrelated and disparate stuff, creating your own order, your own system, imposing your own kind of rationale upon it. Can you say something about what that process looks like, feels like?
I think it's, I was on a panel earlier just now, and someone brought up play, you know, the importance of play in artistic practice, and that's exactly what I do. Everything becomes, there's no hierarchy, everything becomes on the same plane, whether it's, you know, a rough piece of paper I might have found on the floor, or an artwork, or, you know, a piece of vintage design, or a film or video. Everything becomes like neutral but material, and then I play with that material. I mean, when I go to the studio, I play. When I'm installing in a space, I'm playing. When I'm playing records, I'm playing. You know, it's just the process is play, but it's also inquiry. It's also like I want to learn something or discover something through the act of playing. So through the act of playing, I might find something or discover something interesting that I've not seen or heard or thought of before. It may have already existed in the world and someone may have done it before, more than likely, but for me it's a discovery.
You said some things there which I'm really fascinated by. One is that levelling out of putting things all on the same plane. Is that a deliberate suppression of a kind of hierarchy of value in these materials?
It's a sort of deliberate, that's exactly what it is. Because, I mean, I find the value systems around things, specifically art, kind of strange. And in order to work with it, you have to kind of destroy those ideas of value. Otherwise, it's impossible to, like, you can't work with, I have to think of a good example. There's certain things you wouldn't be able to work with. Recently I've been trying to get hold, and I can't because they're too expensive, a Jean Prouveau chair. He designed this chair called the standard chair, which is kind of like a stacking score chair. Mm. Don't know if you're familiar with it. Mm-hmm. But I've been trying to get hold of those to do something with. But if I get one through whichever means, sense would tell me not to cut a hole in it. But for the work, I need to cut a hole in it. So that's where I have to, you know. And it's the same with anything. So a piece of paper on a screwed up piece of paper, or a bit of tape or something, is just as important as that chair at that moment.
And you said that in the process of playing with these materials, that, you know, certain meaning, something comes out of it, which might have existed in the world beforehand, but which you're discovering the process of playing with these materials.
There might be something conceptual or a narrative, or it might be something technical, or it might be, it could be anything. But, you know, all these objects, once they're made into whatever they're, you know, cannibalized and made into whatever, they once again take that hierarchy again. So that's, because I can't control that. I can only change it for myself. I can't change it for the rest of the world.
But what I'm hearing, I guess I'm thinking about education, because it's been a theme of the whole day today. Sure. But it sounds almost like you're creating your own universe, your own educational universe in a way, a world of objects, and then a system of making sense of those objects and creating another meaning or outcome or knowledge out of that.
Sure, but it's a deranged knowledge and a deranged meaning and a deranged logic, you know, so it's deranged as in it might be different to what, like an established idea of knowledge, you know, or epistemology. I guess the most straightforward example is, you know, if I take LEDs and connect an amplifier and some speakers directly to the LEDs and make them flash and you hear a sound, you're not really supposed to do that in electronics. So, but I find that fascinating, and I can follow that through as a logic and a system, as a way of, although it happens anyway, you know, like the way I produce a sound electronically is the way that lights, LED lights work technically, is the same as how analog synthesizers would generate sound. The process is the same. The electronic process is the same. I'm just doing it in a different way through lights, but you're not really supposed to do that. But I can build that logic, which might be a deranged logic, but it's a logic for me. But then, you know, that is an idea that could be spread, you know, that, so the learning, you know, I'm not trying to, if I discover something, I'm not like, oh, that's mine, you know. If I discover something, it's there, you know, but you know, anyone can do it. It is an open source idea or project, I guess.
I think we've got to end there, unfortunately. Right. Too short a time, Haroon, but it's lovely, lovely to speak to you. Thanks so much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you.